Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. So we are going to continue our picture of the Fushimi Inari Shrine in Lizzie Mary Cullen's The Magical Journey. I'll be using my Inktense. Okay, so here I am going to begin with the fire in the sky, or at least that's what I'm going to call it, fire in the sky. And I'm going to use my sun yellow, and the color will pop up for you here on the screen momentarily. I'm taking my sun yellow and I am outlining, well not outlining, but I'm going around the outsides of the flame, and that's where I'm mostly putting it, just on the outer edges and the very tips of the flames. And I think they're flames, so that's what I was going with. And I think it'll have a really cool effect. Next, I'm taking our friend Poppy Red and I'm going to color in the innermost part of the flame and the middle, and then lightly blend it out toward the sun yellow because I want the transition of the colors to be kind of smooth. So I'm not going in with a heavy hand. I did use a heavy hand with the sun yellow just because I want the color to be vibrant, but I do really enjoy using Poppy Red. The color just pops and I was like, is that why they call it Poppy Red? But no, they call it Poppy Red because of the flower, duh. But this color is very, very bright. I love it. So sorry that I am a bit off of the top of the page. I think it's just how I had my tripod positioned, but it's all good. Y'all can see what I'm doing. So now I'm going to come in with my water brush, and I am starting with sun yellow, which is my lightest color, and I'm starting with sun yellow because that is my lightest color and I want that to transition well with the poppy. So if you're coloring along with me on this picture, I hope you're having as much fun as I have been having. I am really enjoying this picture, and like I stated in the first part, if you watched the first part, yeah, I really did get drawn to this picture because of the foxes, and I just think it's an adorable picture. So I'm just trying to blend in my colors, and I'm going to move on over to the other fire flame over here by Mr. Fox number 2. And again, I'm using sun yellow and I am putting it on the outer parts of my flame. We once had a fox, well, it's been a couple of foxes that have been in my neighbor's backyard. I don't know if they have a den nearby because I do live by the woods and I don't see them very often, but it was just lying in the grass like he belonged there. And I was just like, oh, look how cute you are. I wish I could have a fox, a domesticated fox as a pet. Why haven't people domesticated foxes so we can have them as pets? I love foxes. They remind me so much of my dog. I think he looks like a fox in the face. My phone case even has a fox on it. I'll have to take a picture of it and put it in the part of the video when we start to color the foxes so y'all can see. I kind of drew inspiration from my phone case and also pictures of Japanese foxes on Pinterest. I always go on Pinterest when I'm stumped It's a great, great, great springboard for inspiration. Just the photography, like real life photography, I like to see on there when I'm coloring something. Not because I'm a shadow and lighting expert by any means, but I do like to see where shadows are in real life objects and illustrations. I just really like to see how people use color, like in comic books and cartoons. I don't know, I've always been attracted to seeing that type of stuff. It's the inner artist in me, I guess. Okay, so now I am taking Poppy Red, and I'm pretty much essentially doing the same thing that I did for the left side of the page for the fire flame. I'm just putting it toward the middle with a light hand so that it can transition well. I hope these videos aren't too boring for y'all, because it's not my normal coloring chat, but let me tell y'all, this voiceover thing is the best, because I can color and then go sit down or lay down and record my audio, and it's really cool. So I hope that you aren't put off by it, but I am really enjoying it at the moment. Not to say that I won't ever go back to coloring chats, because y'all know, you know, that's my jam, but this is really helpful and I'm digging it to say the least. Just going on the outer parts, and I'm kind of bringing it a little into the tips of the fire flame just so it could look a little more fun. And I almost forgot about a fire flame over there on the left, because I thought it was part of the fox's tail, but you'll see me go back and correct it, because I noticed I had left it out and it wasn't a part of what I thought it was. And that's what I meant about the fun of Lizzie's work. I find it fun to figure out everything. I don't know why, but I really do. So I'm starting with my lightest part of the yellow at the top. You couldn't tell because I was out of frame, and I was just bringing it down to the rest of the flame. And I do plan to go around the yellow, well, the black outline closest to the yellow, with a white gel pen, because it will really make the yellow pop. And when I get rid of that black outline, it'll just make it look a little better. I really like to do fire effects with the ink tints because it's so vibrant. So now you will see me go back over to the left where I forgot that little bit of the flame. So here's sun yellow again. Again with Poppy Red, and I'm doing pretty much the same thing that I already did for the other flames. Now, for the fun part to come in with the water, adding the water is always the fun part for me because you really get to see how the colors come to life. I'm like, how do they do it? I don't know. It's just so pretty. It's like magic. It's like literally watching magic sometimes. Okay, so now I am going to cheat a little bit and I'm going to use a Neo Color 2. And the reason I'm going to use a Neo Color 2 is because I do not have a purple in my current 36 set that I would like to use on this mountain. And if you did not know, yes, that is a mountain in the background, because when you take a closer look, you can kind of make it out. And these colors will move over in a second, and then you'll be able to have periwinkle on the screen. You know, editing is tricky. Okay, so what I'm doing is I'm coloring darker toward the bottom of the mountain, and then I am bringing my color up lightly toward the top. And like I said, the reason I'm using periwinkle is because at the current, I do not have a light purple. I could have used I could have used red violet. If you have the 36 set like me and you don't have Neo Color 2, I think red violet would probably look really good on the mountain, but just do it with a really light hand. But because I have my Neo Color 2, I went ahead and found a light purple. And if you have the full set, you probably have a light purple that you can use. I'm just not aware of which color that is because I do not own that one. So, or you don't even have to make your mountain purple. You can make it brown. You can do whatever you want to do. But this is just my choice right now at the moment. Neo Color 2 also works amazingly well on this paper, just like the ink tints do. And I think this paper can pretty much put up with any water media. Probably watercolor. Probably gouache. Acrylic paint, I know for sure. I have to use gouache in this book. I really gotta make a mental note to use my gouache on a picture in this book to see how it's going to fare, because I think that would be really fun. I'm having fun learning my gouache. I don't use it that often, but when I do use it, trust me, I am using it. So I'm being kind of frantic and messy here in this corner because it doesn't really matter. And just because the crayon is kind of fat, it can't get in that corner. But because we're using water media, our water brush will be able to smooth that out, and we should not have any worries. I should have maybe flattened the spine of my book a little more. I usually do that, actually, for my books. I flatten the spine pretty well, but sometimes I'm afraid that my book might fall apart if I do that, so I don't do it to some books. As you color in it, it'll straighten out. Okay, so now I'm coming in with the fun part, the water. And I try to work in the circular motion when I use Neo Color 2 because I do find that it helps the color to blend better, but sometimes I don't do that. I just do however I want to do at the moment. But I think that I put on a pretty good enough layer. I think the problem with me with Neo Color 2, because I did, when I first got them, I did not like them. I got them because everyone kept doing all these amazing backgrounds with them. And I was like, oh man, I want some of that. So I ordered this set and I hated them at first. I could not get them to work. But I found out that people put like 3 and 4 layers of Neo Color. And I'm like, oh, okay. I personally am too impatient for that. I want my color to be pigmented from Jump Street. And I don't want to put 100 million layers on stuff. So I think that's why my Neo Color 2 does not come out the way I want it most of the time. And also because I am not a patient person when it comes to having it dry. I want it to dry quick like acrylic paint. And it doesn't. Although I do use my blow dryer sometimes to dry out my pages if I'm working with a wet media and I'm not patient. but I'm only going to do this one layer on this mountaintop. And once I put this one layer of water down, I will go back in and just smooth everything out. That's the beauty of NeoColor 2. It's still movable and you can reactivate it with water, unlike the ink tints, which, you know, it sits once you add the water to it. That's pretty much all she wrote. I think I chose to do purple because I think purple will go well on this page, and also because of damn Crayola. Y'all remember that crayon, Purple Mountains Majesty? I don't know why I remember that Crayola crayon, probably because I like to use it a lot and I just like the name. Crayola had cool names for crayons, and every time I look at a mountain, I'm always like, Purple Mountains Majesty, damn you Crayola. So I'm just smoothing everything out, making sure that it's to my liking for my mountain. Making sure I do not forget the bottom. And this little corner over here can be easily forgotten as well. So now I'm going to tackle the flowers here on the bottom right of the page, and I'm going to start with felt green. And felt green is such a lovely color because it's so vibrant and bright when you activate it with water. And I'm going to the right side of my leaf because I want that to be where the brightest part is. And I love, love, love to color leaves and flowers with ink tints because y'all know I cannot stand to color a bunch of leaves and flowers. So anything that's going to help me speed up the process, I'm there for it. And so ink tints really helps me out in that regard. And I'm happy that there are only like 5 leaves on this page and 2 flowers. So, you know, that kind of helped me feel motivated enough to start those things next on the picture. This leaf, it'll be to the left that I want the lightest color, so that's where I'm deciding to put the felt green. And on this leaf here, I'm deciding to put the felt green to the right. And it's so funny, I looked at this picture, I don't know how many times, and I never noticed that it was flowers here at the bottom. Like, I never paid it attention. I was flipping through the book today and I found a couple of more things on the pages that I never noticed before. And I was like, when did that get there? Okay, so here is Ionian Green, and Ionian Green is one of my favorite greens in my ink tint set, and I think it's equivalent to olive green or maybe moss or kelp green in the Prismas. I live for an olive green. I love it in nail polish. It's my favorite green to wear in polish. So I'm going to take Ionian Green and I'm going to put that where I want the darkest part of my leaves to be. And felt and Ionian Green work really well together, in my opinion. I think I use that a lot, actually, this combo, when I am coloring leaves, if I choose to use my ink tints for it. And I'm just trying to get in that spine because it's super weird. and I have to be a bit of a contortionist. My poor page next to this one, which is a page that has a bowl of ramen on it, and I'm just like, that page is gonna have so many different colors. But I'm not worried because I can always try to erase it, and if not, I'll just color over it and it won't bother me. So here I'm using it on the left side of this leaf. And now the fun part, the water. So I'm starting with my lightest green and activating that before I decide to bring in the darkest green. And I really like to use ink tints because I like when it makes the paper a bit crinkly when you put water. I love to use water media on pages for it to have that sound. I love that sound that paper makes when it's wet and it's dry. I know some people can't stand it, but I really like when pages are wrinkly. You can iron your pages as well. I think Coloring with Elena has a video on how you can iron your coloring book pages. But basically, you just put your iron on the lowest setting that it has, and you put a piece of cloth or a piece of paper on top of your picture, of course, to protect it. And then you can iron it and you can make it straight again. I personally am not a stickler for my pages being wrinkly. Like I said, I really like that sound. But if you really want to iron it, you can try. You can give that a try. But because I'm so accident prone and so clumsy, I don't trust myself doing that. Even at my age, using scissors and sharp objects, I'm just very scared to do because I'm so dangerous and the clutch is ridiculous. What I need is safety scissors from like kindergarten. I really need to find a pair of those. So here I'm using felt green and Ionian green, the same colors, and I'm going to do the bottom leaves. And I'm going to put the felt green toward the top and the right of this leaf. And then I'll come in with Ionian green, making it darker at the base. Now I'll move on to our last leaf, and I'm going to use my felt green first, putting down my color where I would like it to be. And more so toward the base of the leaf, and then the outer edges of it is where I would like it to be darker. But I put the felt green down there so that it can just blend nicely. Even though, you know, you see me coloring over top of it with the darker green. But it all helps it to transition, so it's all good. Now I'm taking my water brush and I am activating my color. And there we have our leaves done. And I did notice that I forgot to color my flower stem. And I don't know how I did that. So I did realize it. And I'm going to go back in and color that flower stem. And I'm using the same greens that we just finished with, which were the felt green and the Ionian green. So nothing different there. And I'm not doing anything too exciting. I'm just making sure I shade right under the flower bud and then at the bottom. So So the next colors that we will use are mauve and red violet. I've kindly popped those on the screen for you. And I'm using mauve and red violet because they are in the purple family. And because we used purple on our mountain at the top of the page, I want to bring the purple into the rest of the page and make it all cohesive. And that's why I chose to do my flowers purple. Now, you don't have to do your flowers my color. You can do them whichever color you want. But like I said, because I already have purple incorporated into the page, I just want to continue to have that color represented. And I start with mauve because that's my darkest color. And I'm pointing out where I want my darkest color to be. And I know some people are like, you should color from light to dark and not dark to light. You can do whatever the hell you want to do. You can color however you want to color. There are no real rules. And sometimes I color light to dark. Sometimes I color dark to light. It just depends on how I feel and what look I'm going for. And I like to use my darkest color first a lot, actually, simply because it helps me to pick out my shadows. So if you think that that may help you, feel free to do that. And now I will bring in my red violet, and I'm just going to go banay-nay with my red violet and color it all over my flower because I want it to blend in with the mauve. And I just want to make sure that I cover all the white spaces that I left. And I think it'll be effective that way. Now for the fun part with water, and I'm going to start with my lightest color because, again, I want that to be seen. And I don't want to mix it up too much with the mauve. And I really like how it looks once it gets activated. It's so pretty. I think I've used this color combo before, but I can't quite remember, of course, on what I used it for. But I do like these two colors together. I think they complement each other really well. And they don't get lost in each other, which some colors can. Okay, so the last thing that we are going to color in this video will be our nice big flower down here at the bottom. And I'm going to use the same two colors. I'm going to start with mauve and color all of my dark, shadowy parts that I would like to be seen. And this flower, I honestly thought it was a strawberry sitting on top of some whipped cream in the middle. And I was like, what is food doing in this picture? Although y'all know I would not mind that. But it's not a strawberry sitting on whipped cream. It's the middle of the flower. But in my mind, that's just how I saw it. I don't know why, but I did. So as you can see, I'm coloring my shadow parts in a concave way because I want my petal to look rounded like it has dimension to it. You don't have to do this, but that's just something that I'm going to do for this flower. So I'm just making sure that I give each petal its shape. Even in this tricky corner. And that's pretty much how our flower will look for this part. And when we come back, I'll do the next part. Thank you for watching.